Council of City of Philadelphia to revise five-year financial plan for the City of Philadelphia covering fiscal years 2017 through 2021 and incorporating the proposed changes with respect to the fiscal year 2016, which is to be submitted by the mayor of the Pennsylvania PICA pursuant to the intercooperation agreement authorized by ordinance of this council approved by Mayor January 3rd, 1992, Bill Number 1563-A, and between the city and the authority. With that, I want to welcome everybody here today as we start our hearings, and I want to welcome the First Judicial District. If you could please state your name and proceed with your testimony.
You're right.
Thank you.
Good morning, Councilman Heenan. And to all members of this illustrious council. I am Judge Sheila Wood Skipper, and I am privileged and honored to address you today as the chair of the First Judicial District Administrative Governing Board and the President Judge for the Court of Common Pleas. I am here today representing my colleagues on the Administrative Governing Board, who include the Honorable Marsha Neifeld, President Judge for Municipal Court, the Honorable Jacqueline Allen, Administrative Judge for Trial Division, the Honorable Margaret Murphy, Administrative Judge for our Family Division, the Honorable Matthew Carafiella, Administrative Judge for Orphans Court, and the Honorable Gary Glazer, Administrative Judge for the Traffic Division. The Administrative Governing Board in its current form really is a new configuration. By order of the Supreme Court at the end of January of this year, I was named as chair of this board, and we have new members or newer members. So we are really reconfigurating how we are doing business on behalf of the First Judicial District. So it is in my capacity as chair that I appear before you today representing a unified First Judicial District. Also in attendance with me today is Kevin Cross, our Deputy Court Administrator for Financial Services, here to join me in answering any questions from any member of council about our budget proposal. The mission of our courts is to adjudicate cases according to their jurisdiction and to ensure fair and timely and accessible justice to the citizens and litigants in the city and county of Philadelphia. As the new chair, I seek to create a framework for a vision for our judicial branch that is progressive and collaborative with you and other partners. The judiciary is a co-equal branch of government, separate and not subject to influence, but independent to maintain public trust and confidence in our courts. However, all members of our Administrative Governing Board are willing to dialogue with council members about interests of mutual concern and to partner on initiatives. Inquiries can be addressed to me as chair or to the President Judge of Municipal Court or to any of the individual administrative judges for their divisions. I remind you, however, that we are bound by the limitations placed on judges by the Supreme Court and under the judicial rules of conduct and ethics. The Philadelphia court system enables every litigant to receive their day in court, whether through innovative specialty courts and progressive diversion programs, convenient online court access, multifaceted reentry programs, and by implementing best practices in family and youth services. These proactive initiatives, coupled with our high level of judicial commitment and dedication and productivity, enable the court to meet many societal needs and enhance the lives of all citizens in Philadelphia. You've been given a detailed summary of the testimony today, and in the future, hopefully sometime early summer, we will provide you with a consolidated annual report of the First Judicial District, which will better inform you specifically of all the things that are going on in the First Judicial District. Today, I will simply highlight how the Philadelphia judiciary contributes to its budget, how we remain fiscally responsible, and how we implement new initiatives without seeking additions to our budget, and that we provide a justice system that is not only fair and impartial, but provides accessible services to our citizens who are in need. The fiscal year 2017 FJD budget of $158 million consists of $110.3 million for the general fund and $47.6 million for grants revenue and is awaiting your approval. In large measure, this $158 million budget request is paid for by the court system itself. In fact, the SJD generates $50 million that is credited towards the general fund. And this comes from $34.7 million that are from filing fees, fines, and costs, and $15.3 million that come from reimbursements. In addition, the FJD saves the city and its agencies $3.2 million annually by waiving filing fees in the Court of Common Pleas and Municipal Court, as well as $3.7 million in law library fees. As a consequence, the total budget of $158 million request, in reality, is we're only seeking $53.9 million if you consider all of those factors. Based on the revenue we generate and the fees waived to our partner agencies, the Philadelphia Judiciary's budget is really less than 1.5% of the city's overall general fund budget. The First Judicial District remains a fiscally responsible partner in government. Since 2002, we have reduced our field positions level by 100 employees, and our overtime expenses remain one-tenth of 1% of our Class 100 budget. For the last 2 years, we have not sought any additional funds in our budget, and we remain budget neutral while at the same time continuing to provide innovative and implement new programs. We provide savings to other agencies by collaborating and implementing programs that streamline our case processing and thus reduce costs to the other agencies. We create access and accessibility to our court system. We've done that in terms of our jobs by having a web-based job application where citizens can merely sit at their home computer and make a job online application. And this, of course, saves time, expense, and cost for traveling into the city to do so. As a newly constituted AGB, we have identified diversity in both hiring and in leadership positions as a priority. We are looking carefully at our demographics and diversity in court hires and developing strategies that include working with our Human Resource Department to review our current tests for employment positions to determine if these tests appropriately evaluate a candidate's suitability for any posted position. We're also monitoring our applicants and utilizing best practices to reverse any disparities and discrepancies in our system. And you'll see on the chart that's handed out, we've outlined to you what our demographics are, as well as what we look like in our contracted services. So, additionally, our courts are fully accessible via the internet for online case status, jury duty status, and payment of fines and costs. In 2015, over 700,000 documents were transmitted electronically or e-filed. $2 million were paid online for bail and other fines and services. And over 200,000 individuals used our interactive voice response system to access the status of their traffic division cases. Currently, over 2 million case filings are stored electronically, and the paper file has been eliminated in the majority of our courtrooms. Let's talk about some of the newest initiatives that have been brought forth by the First Judicial District. First, we now have internet access in both of our court buildings, the Family Court and the Juanita Kidd Stout Center for Criminal Justice. So this enables our litigants and our public to access the internet to assist in presenting any testimony. Here in City Hall, since we are tenants here along with the other two branches of government, the executive and the legislative branch, we each have our own independent Wi-Fi. Wouldn't it be nice if we combined our efforts together and collaborated, and perhaps we could get a service that serviced all of us at a reduced cost? Additionally, fueled by the report from the Supreme Court Elder Task Force, we are creating the FJD Elder Care Resource Center. And this will be a comprehensive location to address the needs for services by our elderly and aging population. Individuals will be able to come into the resource room to get information, to make sure that there's equipment available for appropriate hearings, to be referred to appropriate services as needed, to provide education, seminars, and training to safeguard seniors from exploitation, physical and financial abuse, and mental health issues. Our Orphans Court, in dealing with the increasing aging population, is also providing a guardian investigator to review, monitor, and audit guardian reports and filings. Our Traffic Division of Municipal Court has implemented a compliance program so that we can monitor the integrity and professionalism of the court's operation. This program will specify the standards of conduct by which employees are governed and procedures for reporting and the role of a compliance officer who is charged with administering this program. We're also in the process of installing video cameras in the Juanita Kidd Stout Center for Criminal Justice. This is to look out and promote the cause of justice, to deter intimidation, and to foster a safe and secure environment for our victims of crime, our witnesses, and our litigants. We have received partial grant funding to allow us to fund 153 cameras that will be installed in the hallways and common areas of the Stout Center. A vendor has been selected and installation is forthcoming. Additionally, we also received grant funding to secure electronic evidence presentation equipment. And this would allow wireless receivers and monitors that will permit video, pictures, documents, and any other electronic medium to be stored on a mobile device and then transferred to the monitor for presentation in the courtroom. This, of course, will update the ability of the litigants to present evidence in court by use of their laptop, a tablet, or even their mobile phone. Additionally, a new initiative which many of you are aware of is that we received, along with the city and you and other partners, the MacArthur Grant. This grant from this prestigious foundation is a result of an unparalleled collaboration between the city's criminal justice partners, this council, and other partners. The amount of $3.5 million was awarded to address needed changes in the criminal justice system and to make needed reforms. The initiatives that this grant will support will alter the city's prison population, create alternatives to cash bail, establish and enhance diversion and early intervention programs, and address racial and ethnic disparities throughout the justice system. The city is the administrator of this grant, and CJAB, which is the Criminal Justice Advisory Board, is the governance body. Further, as part of our initiatives in municipal court, we have numerous diversion courts and programs that are outlined in the specialty courts and initiatives section of our testimony. And these and other positive reforms have resulted in over 6,700 cases being diverted from the standard calendaring listings and results in cost savings associated with formal trials, with court-related overtime, and lengthy prison stays for nonviolent offenders. We also have reentry programs in both municipal court and common pleas court, which serve as a vital step-down transition from incarceration to assimilating individuals back into the community, and they are proven to reduce the rate of recidivism and improve offender outcomes by providing placement assistance, education, and training. These reentry programs can be pretrial-based or post-trial-based, but they work to make sure that our returning citizens are adequately serviced so that we can prevent the revolving door back into prison. Again, all of these are listed in our written testimony, but also they're listed on our sheet and outline of what those programs entail. In family court, there are many programs and initiatives for children, youth, and families. The family court juvenile branch strives to protect the community from delinquency, impose accountability for offenses committed, and restore and restoration to the victim. In matters involving dependency, the family court creates and maintains best practices to ensure safety and stability of the city's children and families. The Domestic Relations Branch has jurisdiction over paternity establishment, child and spousal support, and custody, divorce, and domestic violence matter. Some of the programs in family court involving children and youth are the Summer Jobs Program, a Sports and Juvenile Justice Program, a Back-to-School Drive, and an Evening Reporting Center, all of which are more detailed in our written testimony. Additionally, we continue to monitor the Residential Mortgage Foreclosure Diversion Program, which is an innovative program that allows homeowners to stave off mortgage foreclosures through conciliation conferences. These conferences are court initiated, conducted with housing counselors, representatives from the Philadelphia Legal Assistance, the Senior Law Center, and Philadelphia VIP. And with assistance from federal and state programs, they help homeowners to achieve a settlement with their mortgage lenders. The court issues a case management order preventing any initial default judgment and schedules a mandatory conciliation conference within 90 days. No default judgment can be entered until the conciliation process is complete. Since the beginning of this program, over 28,000 mortgage foreclosure reconciliation conferences have been conducted, and when a permanent agreement is reached, 85% of these homeowners remain in their home a year later. Over the years, the program has been adjusted and modified to accommodate the changing needs of the community and the litigants. The court welcomes cooperation from City Council in keeping us informed of community and constituent concerns to allow this effective and meaningful program to continue. And lastly, in addition to providing the delivery of fair, timely, and accessible justice to Philadelphians, the First Judicial District should be recognized for its contribution to offsetting its costs and generating revenue for other city agencies. An investment into our courts, judiciary, and staff creates returns that positively impact our justice partners, other city agencies, and our citizens. From children, juvenile, to elders, the FJD is poised and prepared to move forward with new creative, cost-efficient, technology-driven, and inspirational programs for the court and that benefit your constituency. This new leadership and administration of the FJD is determined to be transparent, accessible, and accountable while providing access to justice and our courts. The Administrative Governing Board remains available to discuss any concerns, ideas, and to provide information and education, and we welcome the opportunity to do so. We do request that discussions regarding administration, policy, procedures, and protocols concerning the First Judicial District be directed to the particular members of the Administrative Governing Board and not to individual judges of our court. So I thank you for the opportunity to present this testimony today, and on behalf of the Philadelphia Judiciary, the Administrative Governing Board, and the hardworking and dedicated employees of the First Judicial District, we respectfully seek City Council's consideration and approval of our FY17 General Fund Budget Request and General Revenue Budget Request. And we will take your questions at this time. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Madam President, and welcome to City Council. Again, thank you for your testimony. One thing I've always respected, not just the day-to-day job that you have to do because it's critical for City of Philadelphia is how well you keep data, right? And how well you quantify your savings and how well you associate that with programs. And we're doing that as a city from a budgetary financial in our finance department, with our program-based budgeting. So we could take a cue from what you guys do every day. So in your testimony for the FJD for this current fiscal year, it's reported that you were looking at expanding the GPS monitoring, the electronic monitoring, as an alternative system or program for pre-trial incarceration. Can you give an update of the expansion, and, you know, could you mention or talk about the system that we have now in place for electronic monitoring and how it's more accountable, and you know, with the technology, and how many we currently have, how many can we grow to, and what are the cost savings, and are they associated directly with lowering the recidivism rate?
So what we find with electronic monitoring is that we currently have approximately 650 monitors that can be used for individuals who can be released or not even go in, well, released from custody and be supervised under the electronic monitoring unit. I believe there are currently 10 employees who work and to monitor those units. What that does, it saves costs in terms of prisons, because it costs less to supervise individuals on the street than it does to have them in the prison. And I believe that cost is probably close to $100 per individual. If we can increase the number of monitors or move to the GPS, and we have already put out an RFP for GPS monitoring, this will increase our ability to release low-level offenders from prison, monitor them in another way, and save prisons for individuals who really need to be there. And so really that is our goal, to look at our population. And some of this will be supported as we look at our MacArthur grant and ways to reduce our pretrial population, and this is one of the mechanisms that we wish to use at the court to do that.
What are the eligibilities for an individual to qualify for electronic monitoring?
Well, they look at the nature of the charges. They look at the individual's background in terms of whether they have other court matters and failures to appear, the likelihood that they will appear in court and be a good candidate for supervision on the street, and the overall determination as to whether there are services that can be provided for this individual if they are out of custody that will enable them to be better citizens, to take care of issues they may be having in terms of substance abuse, mental health issues, so they can get treatment out of custody and be better prepared to be a returning citizen that is productive from all ends.
Well, congratulations on the MacArthur grant. Your testimony, I think you stated that there's unparalleled cooperation with the criminal justice system here in the city of Philadelphia. And, you know, we really look forward to, you know, reducing the population, some of your diversionary programs, and incorporating, you know, both the electronic monitoring systems, getting, you know, breaking through any of the barriers that prevent somebody from being eligible for electronic monitoring, as well as video conferencing, which is my next question. Mm-hmm. How is it that you evaluate whether a hearing would allow for remote video conferencing?
So we do video conference at a number of different levels. One is the video crash court, which expedites the adjudication for defendants who are in custody, and expedites the ability of that person to be perhaps released from custody. So there's a list that is generated in municipal court, and those individuals are heard, and it's determined whether or not they can be released based on the nature of the charges, whether or not they are at risk of returning or not appearing at court. We also use video conferencing in our criminal section, where cases, violation hearings, can be conducted from other prisons, either locally or from the state, so that we don't incur the cost of bringing a prisoner in on a bus, because that hearing can be conducted over the video conferencing screen. That also expedites cases through our system and permits us to do these cases a lot sooner in the system if we had to wait for them to be brought down, particularly from the state system, where it takes a much longer time to get them here. So the effort is to expedite and be more efficient in how we handle our cases. There also have been times where we've actually done guilty pleas when individuals in the state custody, I think just recently we did a guilty plea in the state system where an individual is in custody in Rikers in New York. And so the paperwork was all faxed, the lawyer talked to the individual, and a guilty plea was conducted via the video conferencing. I know there have been one or two occasions where we've even had witnesses who may have been in custody testify even before a jury trial with the video conferencing. So it saves us time and it saves money from both a court standpoint, from a prison standpoint in terms of transportation. And also, in some cases, it's even more secure depending on the nature of the individual who's in custody who may be testifying.
All reducing costs, reducing times, getting, moving, the process a lot quicker. How can video conferencing be expanded in order to further reduce, it would reduce overtime and a strain on the budget. Is that a correct statement?
That's correct.
All right, particularly when it regards to the police department. So we just finished at the end of last year a 15-year franchise agreement with Comcast.
Okay.
And one of the things that was negotiated was an iNet. And after iNet is fully implemented in the city, do you think it'd be possible that the officers could be testifying from their district offices through this technology and video conferencing? And I don't know the particulars, and I'm just throwing it out there because again, that would reduce finances, strains on budgets, mm-hmm. Overtime, and expediency on trying to reduce pretrial wait and having the ability to real-time conference and using technology as a tool to do so. Is that, I don't want you to make a statement yes or no, but is that possible in the future at some point?
I always say anything is possible, but that would clearly be a discussion that we would have to have with our justice partners, namely the district attorney and the public defenders and the private defense counsel, because also it's the issue of the right to confrontation of witnesses that appear in court, that normally appear in court. So there would have to be all kinds of agreement to have that done. But, I think we're all moving forward as technology moves forward. So I don't think that anything is impossible, but it certainly would involve a real conversation that would involve others than just the FJD.
Just a discussion as we move forward with the MacArthur grant.
Correct.
And you have everybody cooperating,
correct,
collaborating in the criminal justice system that needs to be a part of it. We just have those conversations and see where technology takes us.
Absolutely. And we have a forum for doing that even separate and apart from MacArthur under the CJAB, where all of our policymakers and decision makers are at the table. So those discussions can be had. And then right, it will be a matter of what agreement we can come to.
Absolutely. Thank you. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Very well.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And good morning.
Good morning, Councilman.
And I want to weigh in and thank you for allowing the rest of us to catch up with the FJD and CJAB on modernizing criminal justice and looking at best practices both implemented by you and by others to try to make sense of how we more efficiently provide safety and justice. So I want to say that all of us are standing on the shoulders of giants. We're standing on some of the work that was already done before it became vogue, before President Obama discovered it. You guys were on top of it, and I want to say that for the record. And thank you again. A couple of things that I just want to get on the record and make sure that, I concur with what the chairman said about the level of cooperation being unprecedented. I see many members of CJAB and also Judge Linder, who is taking on the task on behalf of the administration to kind of work cooperatively together. Can you codify what your diversionary courts in a brief amount synopsis of what those savings have been? quick description of each of the courts and how much that has meant to both doing two things, reducing population on State Road and saving taxpayers money. Because if you are a liberal in your thinking of how to save souls, how to do restorative justice, you can make the case for some of these diversionary courts. If you are more conservative and fiscal minded, you can still make case for these courts because they are saving taxpayers' dollars.
So I always like to start with the fact that not only are they saving dollars and they're creating a more efficient way of doing justice, they really are saving lives. Because what these programs do generally is look at the issues that impact a citizen's ability to be a law-abiding citizen. And I can tell you across the board, they're all the same. Lack of jobs, lack of education, mental health issues, substance abuse, child care. So those are the things that compound criminal justice issues. And if we don't look at those things and identify mechanisms for assisting these individuals, then we will continue to have that revolving door in and out of the criminal justice system. As to the individual program savings, okay, so for municipal court criminal division, their diversion program, there have been over 6,700 cases that have come through that in alternative to formal prosecution. 89% of the DUI treatment court participants have successfully completed the program, and only 15%, so 54 out of 368 graduates have been rearrested. 30 have been convicted for a new crime, which is 8%. So those are really pretty good statistics in terms of people reentering the system.
How much does that save? Instead of having someone spending time on State Road, I think what's important is to quantify your good works to good savings. Mm-hmm. Quantifying what you do and how it also saves taxpayers' dollars.
So I think we have a general number in terms of savings, but if you want some more specific numbers, we can provide that as well. So
let me make it easy, because the clock is ticking.
Yes, it is.
If you were to combine all of the diversionary court, what percentage of savings, dollar amount of savings, do you think those types of programs have saved the city?
Councilman, we can start to work.
Say your name and pull the mic up.
Kevin Cross, Deputy Court Administrator. We can start preparing that information. We will have to look at each individual program and determine how the savings is occurring, whether it's occurring from incarceration costs, whether it's occurring from reduced police overtime or prisoner bring downs. We have some of that information that's provided in some of our courts, but we can do it on a collective basis for all of our diversion programs.
So I think that's important as we move forward. This President Clark has empowered this council to look at how we can help you by bringing to scale those courts that are efficient and saving money and reducing population on State Road. If we can figure that out, then you say to me that the Veterans Court saves us money, or the Gun Court saves us money, or if those things can be brought to scale and we can make significant savings and reduction, I think those are worthwhile investments. The second part of this is, in conjunction with them, I'm going to ask each of the departments that are under public safety today this same question. Where do you stand on GPS technology? I think I've heard that. Where do you stand on day reporting centers as an alternative to incarceration? And for big bucks, where do you stand on no cash bail?
All right, so we've already covered the GPS, so I won't go back over that. But I know that in the juvenile system, we do have day reporting. Also know that as part of the whole MacArthur initiative, looking at day reporting and the no cash bail are going to be two of the prominent issues that will be discussed and raised under that MacArthur Group. And so there is viable consideration of all of those things. So I would just say this, adapt, wait and see, to just see what recommendations and strategies are developed as a result of the collaboration through MacArthur. Again, everything is on the table, and I think we are poised at this point. We have all the right people and the right players there who are willing to put forth effort in creating systems that are going to better serve the community at large and to address the issues that you've raised.
So if I were in court, I would rephrase the question and say you're not in opposition to any of those possibilities.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Finally, what I want you to touch on risk assessment. And in my limited capacity mm-hmm. with CJAB and PCCD, Pennsylvania Crime and Delinquency Commission, and now with the task force, we're looking at trying to update who constitutes a risk to the public or themselves and reevaluating that to see who needs to be incarcerated versus sent to some of these diversionary programs. Where is that whole analysis, re-examination of the issue of risk assessment?
Okay, so in our probation, we have a risk assessment tool that is being utilized for them to determine the level of supervision that is required. That was developed under...
1970s.
No, that's a more recent that was developed... What was that?
University of Pennsylvania.
By University of Pennsylvania. Over, I don't...
80s?
No. With eight, no.
Last five, 10 years.
In the last 5 to 10 years.
Okay. Yeah, it's been updated.
All right.
What year? In 2007. Okay. So it's old, but, you know, we're always revisiting that. And, again, that's another item that will come up under the MacArthur discussions and as we strategize and looking at which individuals need to remain in custody, what level of supervision is necessary. And that's all a mechanism to determine, one, staffing requirements. You know, do you need more staffers for high-risk individuals, less staffers for low risk? Is also going to come up on another angle because I also serve as chair of the Pennsylvania Sentencing Commission, and we have been delegated to provide a risk tool for sentencing. So there's going to be another mechanism that's going to be coming forth for judges and others to look to determine appropriate sentences. Or is there alternatives based on how an individual was assessed? So that's going to be forthcoming. And as a matter of fact, Philadelphia is one of the pilot counties where that will be tested.
Mr. Chairman, I just would say probably the most germane thing we can take a hard look at is that you can never predict what someone is going to do 100%, but we can minimize those individuals that could possibly be given alternatives to incarceration by this one tool. So the no cash bail and that are probably the two pillars by which we will make further decisions, because I think it's 60% of folk up there are there because they can't afford bail at state room. And that is like more like debtor's prison than actually protecting the public. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman. And, you know, I just want to commend you for your diligence in seeing through some of these things that you've been championing for many, many years, especially when it comes to day reporting and reducing our population and looking for those data sets to help better our citizens. Chair recognizes Councilman Dunn.
Thank you, Chairman Heenan, and good morning.
Good morning.
President Judge, I have a few quick questions for you. Right now, is there any backlog, or what roughly you can tell me the backlog for cases going through the court systems, whether it's common pleas, municipal court, or the divisions underneath those? What is the time frame for each court as far as backlog is concerned?
Let me see if we have that information here today. Right, we do. All right, I don't have specific numbers to detail whether or not, in fact, we actually have a backlog. We know that in our PCRA, our post-conviction unit, we do have some backlog, some related to the juvenile lifers only because the Supreme Court has just made a ruling concerning those, others related to lack of counsel to take those cases through the system. And so we are working diligently with our justice partners to develop mechanisms and protocols to relieve any of that backlog and to move forward with those PCRAs. As to our criminal trials in general, because of the nature of the programming that we have programs for early resolution. We have what we call smart rooms where cases are sent fairly quickly from arraignment, where they can be resolved quickly either through plea or some other mechanism. And so we look to deal with cases as early on in the system as possible. We look to divert cases earlier on in the system, probably at arraignment, where they're diverted to particular programs, either the reentry programs or diversionary programs. Judges are diligent in trying to move cases forward, making sure that requests for continuances are legitimate requests and not those that's meant just to delay the process. So we try to make sure that we keep tabs. We can, if you like, try to get any specific numbers, but overall, I think we're doing pretty good.
So I would like the specific numbers maybe shared with the City Council.
Very well.
For each court, what the backlog is. And by the way, this presentation you gave us, I thought was excellent.
Thank you.
Really good. Very good. The other question I have is on the, if I understand the numbers correctly, in your testimony, the cost to fund the court system is about $54 million, roughly. Ballpark. At the end of the day.
Once.
Net of all of our revenue.
Right, correct. Once you net the revenue.
And so the filing fees, the fines and costs that are $34 million, are those who pays those filing fees and fines and costs? Are they paid at the court hearing, or how do they get paid?
They are paid. They are paid through the electronic system, and normally not there in court, but there's a process where they go to a counter and they can pay there, or they can pay online.
Do they have to be paid in advance of hearing the case?
Councilman, this is Kevin Cross. For civil cases, for our electronic filings, the fees are paid when the motion or petition or pleading is filed. So if the pleading is uploaded into the system and a credit card transaction occurs to post the payment.
So you would not have any delinquencies then, would you?
Not in our civil cases, no. We have some unpaid fines and costs.
Do you have unpaid fines in other areas? How much would that be?
I don't have those numbers here, but we can get those for you.
Okay, I'd like to know what those are and what they represent and what we're doing about collecting those. And the other question is, when's the last time we've looked at changing the fees and fines and costs and raising them so the city would put out less money in our budget?
The fees, fines, and costs, I don't think we've looked at. Some of them are statutory, and so they would have to be changed by legislation.
It's okay.
So 1984. So that's certainly something that...
1984.
That's what I'm told.
That's the George Orwell book, isn't it, 1984? Is that something we could work with you on to maybe consider that it's been, how many years is that, 33 years? 32 years that we haven't changed the fees?
Right, and that's for criminal cases. In terms of civil...
Well, I'd like to suggest, and I'm happy to work with you, is to review all fees, and let's see if we can get the numbers down that it costs the city. Clearly, if it hasn't been changed since 1984, it's something we should go to our legislators and say, this is ridiculous. Mm-hmm. We need to adjust this.
Very good.
I'm just looking to save the city money. And you'll look better by asking us for less money, too. You'll look great.
Of course, they may decide just to raise everything, too, right?
So can we work on that and have a follow-up to that?
Yes, we'll take note of that. I also just wanted to go back to your original question about the backlog. I will note that if you look at page 9 of the testimony, it does indicate that our clearance rates in all divisions is over 100%, meaning that we clear more cases than are brought in at the end of the year.
If someone asked you this question, what's the average time it takes to go through the court system when you file a case in Philadelphia? How would you answer that?
So on the civil side, we are within the ABA standards, and the cases are done, I think, in less than 24 months. On the criminal side, it depends, because it depends on the nature of the case. For instance, it may take a homicide a longer time to go through the system. It may take a felony case that goes to early resolution could be resolved within 4 weeks of the arraignment. So that's going to vary depending on the case and the complexity of the case.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councilman. Thank Chair you. Recognizes Councilman Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good morning.
Good morning today. I first and foremost want to congratulate you on your new position.
Thank you.
As well as a very, very strong, comprehensive, and detailed presentation.
Thank you.
Probably one of the most detailed we've seen thus far, at least in my very short, brief lifetime as a council person. But I just want to thank you for your service as well.
Thank you.
I want to focus on support for our young people, juvenile reentry, juvenile justice. And you specifically listed a overview of programs that appear to be very successful in supporting our youth, specifically the new employment opportunities for non-custodial parents, the summer jobs program with Philadelphia Youth Network, alternative to secure detention initiative, and juvenile treatment court. Those are key ones that stuck out to me specifically because, one, we know most young people want to focus on trying to obtain a job during the summertime so they don't have to stand on the corner hustling or get involved in other types of crime and violence to put money in their pocket. But there's also a mental health component because I know from working on the ground in the neighborhood, the level of mental health and drug addiction issues that some of our young people have through self-medicating based upon the environment in which they are living in. So I was pleased to see those particular initiatives and would like to see how you will focus on building upon these initiatives moving forward in the future, but also specifically when it comes to the issue of gun violence amongst young people. I know we do a lot of work on the adult level. I often go to Greater Ford with Councilman Curtis Jones to work with the lifers and individuals on state road, but I also recognize that the people who are carrying guns are becoming younger and younger. Mm-hmm. And so are there any specific initiatives that focus on young men, in some cases, young ladies that engage in straw purchasing? And this will probably be another conversation for another department down the line as well. But just give me an overview. Are there any initiatives that specifically on a juvenile level that we focus on that deals with young men carrying guns? And then from your perspective, the best practices that you deem successful in terms of initiatives, how can we continue to build on them and be supportive as a city to support our young people who are going to the family court system so they won't become career criminals? Because I'm a firm advocate, if we invest on the front end, then we don't have to deal with down the line young men on state road, young people going to Greater Fort. And the last part of that reentry component, when that young man goes to Glen Mills, he goes to Slayton Farms, what's the transition process to reintegrate them back into society? Because I know at one time, the issue of the school district, from a report that I saw from Philadelphia Youth Network, was the issue in terms of school district and foster care. So that's the threefold question. How can we be supportive to help build on your best practice initiative? Two, youth gun violence initiatives, particularly for young people that carry guns. And then three, the reentry. When a young man comes home from Glen Mills or placement or a youth study center, or young ladies, how do we reintegrate them back into society?
So I think if we look first in terms of the program with gun violence, we have the youth violence reduction program that works with juveniles in terms of giving them supervision and direction to keep them out of the system or returning back to the system. And I don't think the reentry opportunities, the reentry concerns are any different from youth than they are for adults, because it's still the same issues. Are they getting education? Or do they have mentoring and strong support systems? Do they have a place to stay? Do they have food on their tables? You know, for the older youth, are they having summer employment to keep them out of trouble, as you mentioned? So we are supportive of any efforts that continue the court's general theme of making sure that people who are reentering society are getting the tools that they need not to go back. And I think preventiveness is the best tool. So if we work on the front end to make sure that our young people are getting the education that they need, that they're getting the support mechanisms that they need in terms of creative programming, having mentors, giving them positive role models and peer specialists who can discuss with them and treat any of their issues concerning substance abuse, mental health issues, parental concerns, and really just navigating through our system in the city of Philadelphia, dealing with peer pressure, which is, I think, one of the biggest things that causes an individual, a youngster, to go into a different way of life, because the pressure of others pushing them in that direction. And so we need to be there as a mechanism to give them an alternative.
Do we have specific numbers on young people who are arrested for guns and gun crimes? Specifically juveniles?
I don't think we have that in our testimony today, but we certainly can get that information for you as well.
And I know my time is about to wrap up. What do you consider challenges or levels of support that will enhance the work that you guys are doing? And I know money always plays a part, so we...
It's always money and resources. And as I've identified the resources, those are the same resources that we need in just about every program that we're dealing with in the court. And we have many justice partners or service providers who work with us. But, you know, when you have these programs where people need housing, so they need to have identification. So we need people working to make sure they have birth certificates. If they're having Social Security, if they're incarcerated, and that gets cut off, then it has to be turned on before certain services can be provided. We need a mechanism for paying for the treatment. And so it always revolves around money, but it's the resources and having the collaboration and consistency among the programs that'll help.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Green.
Thank you, Chairman Heenan. Good morning.
Good morning.
President Judge Skipper, Wood Skipper, excuse me, I want to commend you and also Administrative Judge Allen for your leadership. The First Judicial District, I think it sends a strong message when we have two women of color leading our judicial system here in the city of Philadelphia. I want to thank you for your leadership. And also it speaks to the fact that the city was successful in the MacArthur Grant through your cooperative relationship with various entities in our public safety arena, working with District Attorney's Office, Public Defender's Office, and the city in getting that grant. I think it also speaks volumes about the way that your leadership has helped to work collaboratively. And also reflects on hearings I had earlier this year when I talked about social impact bonds or pay for success bonds and looked at the Choice is Yours model as a way to provide additional funding for recidivism. And I think the MacArthur Grant provides some additional dollars in that regard.
That's correct.
So thank you in that perspective. Looking at your budget testimony, you indicated a net cost of about $54 million to the City of Philadelphia, and I think that's good financial stewardship. But it also reminds me of an ongoing, a long simmering, I'll just say legal debate regarding who's responsible for paying the costs for our court system. As you know, under the Pennsylvania Constitution, we're supposed to have a united judicial system, and when Governor Rendell was mayor, there was litigation. I know the Pennsylvania County Commissioner Association actually sued the Commonwealth not once but twice, and there was a writ of mandamus in reference to funding. So I'm curious, in reference to that ongoing discussion, what thoughts you may have in that regard.
So there really is nothing new regarding that. I'll defer to what the statute says and what the state of the law is. It is what it is, but nothing has happened to push that forward at this point. Kevin, is there anything you want to add, everybody?
No, there has been no new action that we're aware of at the legislative branch or at the executive branch at the Commonwealth.
And who is the current liaison from the Pennsylvania Supreme Court to the First Judicial District?
We do not have a judicial liaison anymore.
Okay,
as of the end of January.
Do you have any perspective on when that appointment may occur? I know there's been some dynamics in the Supreme Court, but have you given any indication?
We are told that we will know, because we are the only judicial district that ever had a judicial liaison. We are told that we will not have a judicial liaison.
Oh, so you understand that there will not be a liaison to the first?
Correct. That is my information.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Ginn.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
And I also want to add my voice to the accolades that are being delivered to you, in your current role and but also in terms of the presentation, I thought was incredibly helpful, very thorough in terms of outcomes, and gave a really great snapshot of what we're looking at. I also wanted to thank the district for a lot of programs that you've engaged in, even beyond the MacArthur Foundation grant, which will be, I think, historic and dramatic for our city, but also the Mortgage Foreclosure Diversion Program, Project Dawn, which I think is a really important aspect of work, and especially in broadening understanding about sex workers and that industry. So I want to thank you for all of that.
Thank you.
Some of my questions have to do with juvenile justice and trying better to understand the process about juvenile placement. These were some questions that came up following the DHS testimony in particular. Could you talk a little bit about what are some of the factors which led to the increase in dependent adjudications between 2014 and 2015? So that was an increase of about 17%.
I am actually, because I don't sit in the juvenile program, I'm going to actually defer that question to Administrative Judge Margaret Murphy, who's not here today, not available today, because I don't want to misspeak on that, and I'm not familiar with those numbers at this point.
And, you know, I think that's just when we see, you know, a rise in that level, it's helpful to understand a little bit about what's happening around that. And among the questions similarly is for youth delinquency cases that actually result in placement, what does the family court do to evaluate outcomes for youth by provider to better understand the decisions that are being made by judges to place young people with specific providers? I know you have aggregate numbers in terms of high school diplomas, you know, returning GEDs, but do you look at this by actual provider?
Again, other than the numbers that I presented to you per our testimony today, I would have to defer to Judge Murphy for more specifics in terms of if they look at particular providers and make those determinations. So we will certainly make a note and have her get back to you regarding that information.
Yesterday in testimony, it was presented to us that DHS may not actually be providing that information directly to the courts. And do you feel like that type of information is important or for judges in order to understand which placement options are quality options for our young people?
speaking personally, I certainly would want to know, particularly if I'm sending an individual to a particular facility, be it a provider or a treatment facility, that they are performing the job that we expect them to do. And if there are issues or concerns, I would want to be aware of that, so that if there's anything that needs to be done to intercede, to make sure that they're fulfilling the obligation and meeting the needs in your case, the children, that's being done. So I would think we would want to know that.
Yes. And is there a venue in which DHS and the courts can communicate about that kind of information?
Absolutely. That type of information would be brought to the attention directly of the administrative judge, Judge Murphy, who could then take whatever measures she deemed necessary as a result to take corrective action.
Thank you very much. You know, one of the other areas that we're trying to press on is about children who are under court supervision and some of the data that's come out about how they're cared for. And of course, the broad majority, 95% of them, are either in a home, kinship care, foster care, or congregate care. But there is about 5% who are not and are therefore in some sort of a detainment center or hospital as a result. With no kinds of direction about what the end outcome is for them. And if we're looking at these numbers of 2,500, 2,496, I don't know if that's the accurate number to use, that would be about 125 young people. Can you talk a little bit about what happens to those young people who don't actually find a placement, and what is the detainment center or hospital situation that they're placed in?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the last portion of that?
Could you talk a little bit about what does happen to the young people who do not actually achieve any kind of placement and thus are left in some sort of a detainment center or hospital? And maybe if you could be specific about what that detainment center actually is.
Very good. So once again, because I really don't want to misspeak and I'm not specifically familiar with the details that you are requiring or asking about, I'd like to defer that question to Judge Murphy and ask her to get back with a detailed response concerning your question.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Parker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning to each of you.
Good morning.
I'm showing my... You know, we use these phones, but I'll tell you, my age is starting to show. I've refused to enlarge the print, so you just bear with me a second, okay?
Take your time.
My question is in regards to the turnover rate. And if you've already addressed this, I apologize. Just, you know, refresh the record for my benefit, if you will, of probation officers and sort of the cost for reinvesting in sort of providing competitive salaries so that we can reduce that turnover rate. Can you just give us some context of that issue?
So I think it's generally perceived that our probation officers turn over more maybe than other employment. And the general reason being because the counties, the state, and the federal government usually have higher salaries. So we lose an average of 20 to 25 probation officers a year, usually to any of those other entities. And so right now we have 277 probation officers, and they're carrying a total caseload of 250 people. So it represents like 9% of our workforce.
You said 9?
9%.
9%, uh-huh.
Right. The salaries in a recent, negotiation, the salaries have been raised. They were raised for 3%, and then that resulted in an increase in salary for the probation officers, and at the end of that, the end contract will increase the salary again by 3% this year. So for the last 3 years, they have been getting some increase in salaries. But I still don't think it's necessarily comparable to what they're making out in the other areas. Mm-hmm. So we are obviously taking a hard look at that because, you know, we don't like to train our probation officers, and we train them well here.
And then they go somewhere else.
So we have to look at how we can retain them. And I believe that salary is probably the easiest generator of how we can maintain our probation officers here and keep the expertise where we've trained them in here in our own system.
Great. Well, that was my question, and I wanted to make sure that we talked about a competitive salary as a way to alleviate and or plug that brain drain that you just referenced. Okay. Because what you just described is sort of equivalent to what we hear from pre-K providers. Yeah. Sort of they'll get teachers will get great training when they go out to get academic assistance, and then they come back as soon as a job opens up with the School District of Philadelphia. They leave the neighborhood based education center, and then they go to work with the school district because the salary is better, the benefits are better, and so forth. So I just want the record to reflect that that is something that we should take a hard look at it. Okay. And thank you for your response.
And thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just had a few additional follow-up questions. Looking at page 2 of your testimony, you talked about a new initiative, the FJD Elder Care Resource Center. Is that center up and running as of yet?
Not yet, but we are in the process of conforming it to meet the standards that we need in terms of accessibility for the elderly and the handicapped. And shoring up some staff that we're going to provide in-house, but we also need to have some additional funding so that we can staff it with advocates that will work with the seniors or anyone that comes into the center. But we are hopeful that we will have it up and at least a soft opening by the beginning of the summer. So it's coming.
Okay, good. One of the reasons I had some inquiries, one, as chair of the Council Committee on Disabilities, definitely encourage the fact you're taking steps to help people that have mobility issues. Two, talking with a colleague, Councilman Tonberger, who is the chair of the Council Committee on Aging, and I'm the vice chair, we're talking about having hearings possibly in the fall regarding financial fraud as it pertains to elders. So having that information, considering you'll be doing workshops and resource
Absolutely.
Opportunities, that would be a good opportunity to work in a collaborative fashion with some of the work that you're doing.
Absolutely.
And we've also had a conversation with AARP, who do, you know, telephone town halls, so some of the work that you're doing can be plugged into that. Following up on some questions that Councilman Parker asked in reference to salary, it made me think of often when you talk about salary, you're also sometimes dealing with collective bargaining or other type of negotiations. Are there current situations from a negotiation perspective that the First Judicial District is in at this point?
I am not aware that we are involved at this point in any negotiations right now. I think we do have some that may be forthcoming, mm-hmm. but right now I think we are not.
Okay, so what are those contracts that are forthcoming?
Let me start by saying that any of the economic issues are negotiated with the city. We're not involved in that. We only deal with the operational and job performance kinds of issues. And I'm not sure, is there one that's coming up? I may have misspoken. Maybe we are not aware of any at this moment that are coming up.
Okay. And also, a follow up on when you talk about salary, also promotional opportunities are also important. And you provided in the budget detail, I believe on page 6, some of the demographics of full-time staff, both male and female, as well as executive staff, as well as ethnicity. Do you have that information by way of department so we can see where people are from all different perspectives in different departments, like, for example, juvenile probation or traffic, so we can see where people are located?
We don't have it available today, but we can provide that. We do keep that.
And also, what type of initiatives do you have within the court system to provide promotional opportunities within various departments?
So depending on the department, certain positions require particular trainings and certifications. And so one of the things we are looking at, as I mentioned, is our testing for particular posted job positions to determine whether they adequately reflect whether an individual can do the job. all of our departments are now looking, because this is really a focus for us, and to look to determine promotional opportunities for members of our district, because one, we want to keep our good employees here, and we want to give them a hope that there's opportunities to move up into different positions. So we are looking in each department to develop strategies to make sure that we are doing that. So I can't give you specifics for each division right now, but that is on the radar, and it is a priority for us.
Okay. Yeah, to the extent that you can provide that to the chair, that can be disseminated to other members, to all members of council, because when we talk about not only salary but also promotional opportunities, it's also important to make sure that both in the line staff as well as the executive staff and all departments in the First Judicial District should reflect the City of Philadelphia. So we want to make sure that staff that comes in sees a diverse executive staff, so that way they continue to seek promotional opportunities within the First Judicial District and not go outside to other agencies.
Correct. Understood, and it's something that certainly we are taking note of, and it's definitely high on our radar. I would just note that some of our higher executive positions, some of the court administration positions, are state positions and not funded by the First Judicial District.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Kim.
Hi. Thank you very much. Can you talk a little bit more about the work that's being done by the new guardian investigator for in the Orphans Court, and maybe a little bit about how many files they're able to review and or audit, or any findings you've come through that work of that new position?
All right, so this is obviously a new position brought on about because of concerns or whether or not guardians who were being appointed were actually doing the work and having the oversight that was necessary to make sure that this was doing well. So we don't have any statistics as of yet because it is a new position, but that guardian investigator is really responsible for being the individual who is on top of the guardian to make sure that they are filing the appropriate paperwork, that they're looking out for the interests of the individual that they're to be guard, that they've been appointed guardian is, and to make sure that they're making appropriate reports back to the court. And then if there's a need for the court to intercede to develop more training and expertise among the guardians, that's going to be taken on as well. So we're looking to develop that role, but it is a work in progress.
And when did that position come online?
Okay, so the job specifications are being prepared now, so it has not, that
you've
person
not hired.
Has not hired, but that's the expectation.
Okay, great. And one of the issues that I know, if you could work with the Committee on Children and Youth a little bit, as well as I'm sure the Council on Committee on Aging, mm-hmm. is if you're noticing any patterns or issues that start to arise from your work. So. And then I guess my second question would be if there's anything to pivot a little bit towards the issue of eviction, if there's anything that you think the city can do in order to ensure that parties who are involved at the point of eviction, whether individuals can have access to legal advice and representation.
I guess I'm, when you say can they have...
can the city ensure, mm-hmm. if we recognize eviction in particular mm-hmm. as being a very devastating type of mm-hmm. issue for families that we know through national data that they tend to... primarily impact single female heads of household with mm-hmm. children, mm-hmm. that we then put young people in a dangerous situation and families in a situation where both not only could they go out onto the streets, but that oftentimes the loss of a home can mean removal of care mm-hmm. from a family, that this is a very, very serious issue that has impact that reverberates throughout multiple systems. It's come to light through some of the national data that's been out there that many people at the point of eviction lack any legal representation. They may have an option to call a number, but they would largely have to pay or get in line for a long line for legal services. But there's no right to legal representation in an eviction situation. And I am interested in asking whether, you know, given the cases that you've seen and what's been going on, whether you feel like there's more that the city can do to provide individuals at the point of eviction with legal representation.
We always think that legal representation will help to protect an individual's rights. So any, I think, resources that can be developed or any programming that can be developed to assist, we know that there are particular groups or agencies that do provide volunteer assistance to individuals who may be in that situation, but it may be something that perhaps a collaborative effort to develop a program that would address that would be certainly something that would be warranted. And again, I would defer that one, since that comes under President Judge Marsha Nyfield as a municipal court, I would defer that to her for her consideration and for further discussion surrounding that.
And is there a place where some of those conversations can happen with a broader dialogue around it? I mean, part of it is that there's been a number of, you know, increasing attention to the fact that New York City, for example, has put in a lot of money into legal representation and ensuring that its residents have legal representation at the point of eviction, and has seen a significant decline in evictions as a result. And is there a space, I mean, other than just individual kinds of dialogue, is there another space where some of these conversations can occur?
Well, obviously, I would recommend the initial conversation yes. be had with her, but then we can always convene a group of collaborative partners who have various interests in this issue and have a discussion about how, what strategies can be developed to address your concerns, and I'm sure that can take place. We do so many things collaboratively, I don't think it would be a big issue at all.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Dunn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, I have one question, one last question. Mm-hmm. I noticed that, which is really positive, you collected $35 million in back taxes under sequestration. Yeah. That's basically where you take over the someone paying a bill and they pay it to us instead of someone else. Can you explain that process and how we could expand that?
So the sequestration project is a means for the city to collect overdue taxes. So this project was developed in our civil commerce program, and hearings are conducted and a petition is filed to appoint a sequester. For looking at the commercial properties where tax liens have been filed. And during that program, the city, as you indicated, has obtained $35 million, and half of that money goes to the school district. So the court really acts as a mediator in collecting, providing a process for individuals to sit at it and collect those funds and get those paid so that the back taxes are done.
So you've collected $35 million over a year, 2 years? What's the time frame? Yes.
Three and a half years.
Correct. But we have right now $350 million in delinquent real estate taxes and $150 million of delinquent water and sewer. Can we attack those delinquencies through this program?
I would probably have that discussion with Judge McInerney, who's the supervising judge for the Commerce Program, to see whether or not that program can be expanded. Right now, we have three judges who sit in that program, and obviously, this is not their only role. It's the sequester program. It's not the sequester program, but I can certainly have that discussion with her and get her views and opinion as to whether or not it can be expanded.
Okay, so you can get back to us on that.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councilman. Are there any other members wish to have any follow-up questions for the President Judge? All right, well, thank you. President Judge, we appreciate your time. We appreciate your testimony and what you do on a daily basis, and look forward to having an open and communicative type of correspondence and dialogue moving forward. So thank you so much for your time today.
And thank you as well. And again, we again always are open and willing to communicate and have discussions. So thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you for your time.